All right. We'll just discuss our results now.
In this experiment, the main objective is to determine the constant acceleration. To do this, we have set up a system where there is a ramp at a 20 degree incline and a cart that is on this ramp. The cart has a magnetic damper with a force sensor attached to it, which allows it to measure forces throughout its journey up the ramp. The force sensor measures internal forces between the bumper and the cart. The combined mass of the cart is 345 grams, give or take 2 grams. The cart has a cable attached to a suspended mass of 251 grams through a pulley system. In our experiment, we will run the cart with a magnetic damper facing up and facing down, which causes a magnetic damping force with an offset of 4.5 millimeters. The smart cart was connected to a software called Pasco Capstone. This software allowed us to view the data in real time and use it to plot graphs with extreme accuracy. In this experiment, we have also stated assumptions when analyzing calculations. We have stated that friction acting on the cart is negligible and there is no slack in the cables. So when the cart is released, the cable should be in tension. The pulley is also weightless and frictionless. The cart has a constant mass of 345 grams and there is no acceleration in the vertical direction.
After treating the experiment as a pulley system, we were able to draw free body diagrams of the event. The acceleration of the cart is found by equating tensions of the string attached to the cart and suspended mass. We assume that the vertical acceleration of the suspended mass and the horizontal acceleration of the cart are equal, and also that the tensions were the same as they are both attached to the same string, thus giving an acceleration of 2.19 meters per second squared. After that, by using the differential equation linking acceleration, velocity, and time, we substitute acceleration into the equation A equals dv over dt. This equation is then integrated to find velocity with respect to time. The initial condition of when time is zero and velocity is zero is applied to find the constant of integration C, which happens to be zero, so v equals 2.19t. Then, for the equation of displacement, using a differential equation linking velocity, displacement, and time, we substitute the velocity into the equation v equals ds over dt. This equation is then integrated to find displacement with respect to time. The initial condition of when time is zero and displacement is zero is applied to find the constant of integration c, which happens to be zero again this time. Hence, our displacement equation is s equals 2.19t squared over 2. Initial conditions are needed to be applied as the equations are being integrated without limits and therefore would have constants of integration.
From the theoretical acceleration versus time graph, we see that there is a linear relationship which indicates that there is a constant acceleration of 2.19 meters per second. As we can see, both the theoretical and experimental data follow the same shape, meaning our findings respect the mechanics of dynamics. However, we can see a slight difference between the graphs. From the graph, we can see that there is a directly proportional relationship between the theoretical velocity and the time. As we can see, both the theoretical and experimental data follow the same shape, meaning our findings respect to the mechanics of dynamics. However, if we compare the experimental velocity against the time to the theoretical velocity against time, we can see that the experimental is relatively close but slightly off. On the theoretical time versus displacement graph, we can see that it follows an exponential curve. As we can see, both the theoretical and experimental data follow the same shape, meaning our findings respect to the mechanics of dynamics. However, we can see a slight difference between the graph. At 0.4 seconds, we can see there is a theoretical displacement of 0.18 meters and there is an experimental displacement of 0.15 meters. When comparing the theoretical data to the experimental, we notice slight discrepancies within the data. The main reason for the discrepancy is due to human error. When the car was released, it could have been bumped, which causes an increase in the experimental data. In this experiment, we have negated friction, whereas in the real world, friction acts on the cart. This change could also affect the acceleration. Another possibility for this occurrence could be due to the cable having a small amount of slack before being released, or the cable was slightly stretched when it was released.
When calculating the mass of the bumper, we decided to use a reasonable range of data. With the dataset that we collected, we decided to cut it from 0.65 to 1.25 seconds. This was because there was no noticeable change in displacement in the first 0.65 seconds, and therefore assumed to be stationary. Using the data from before 0.65 seconds would cause our force and acceleration averages to alter, therefore affecting our average mass of the bumper calculated. Data used for the graphs are taken from the changed time intervals, around 0.65 seconds. We can see that it has moved a significant enough distance to register a change of position. When calculating the mass of the bumper, we use the time interval between 0.65 and 1.25 seconds. We averaged the force and the acceleration between the interval, where the force acting on the bumper was estimated around 0.132 newton, 4 meters per second. Since we had zeroed the force sensor before starting the experiment, the angle can be ignored. Both the bumper and the car experienced the same acceleration since they are connected, and therefore were treated as one body during the calculation.
For experiment 2, the same assumptions and free body diagrams are used from experiment 1. However, the damping constant K is close to the true value.
damping force is given by the damping coefficient times by the velocity. The equation is rearranged to show that the damping coefficient is proportional to the force divided by the velocity. This relationship is then graphed with the damping coefficient as the gradient. A trend line is fitted to the graph and is forced to the origin, as there should be no force when the car is stationary. The equation of the trend line shows that the damping coefficient is 0.5694. Total acceleration is given by the constant acceleration minus the damping force. To find the velocity, then use the differential equation that links acceleration, velocity, and time, which is A equals dv over dt. A is then substituted into this equation, rearranged, and integrated to find velocity in terms of time. Initial conditions of when time, velocity, or displacement is zero is needed to be applied to each of the differential equations, as the equations are being integrated without limits and have constants of integration. To find displacement, we use the differential equation that links velocity, displacement, and time, which is v equals ds over dt. The velocity equation is then substituted into this equation, and then it is integrated. Theoretical and experimental acceleration both show the same overall trend, decreasing acceleration over time due to the damping force slowing down the car. The experimental data, however, shows that initial acceleration around 1 meter per second is much slower than the theoretical acceleration, which is around 1.6 meters per second squared. The experimental data then follows the theoretical data closely until the 0.3 second mark, where the experimental acceleration begins to increase to a maximum of 1.1 meters per second squared at 0.45 seconds. The increase of experimental acceleration after 0.3 seconds compared to the theoretical can be seen as a result of an error. The experimental velocity begins at 0.038 meters per second due to where we have selected our data. Both the experimental and theoretical velocities follow the same logarithmic curve upwards. We can see from the graph that the theoretical velocity is greater than the experimental velocity after around 0.05 seconds, reaching a difference of around 0.1 meters per second at 0.475 seconds. Looking back at our acceleration data, we can see that the average theoretical acceleration is higher than the average experimental acceleration. Since the theoretical acceleration has greater advantage, we can expect that the theoretical velocity will be greater at 0.475 seconds compared to the experimental velocity. Both the experimental and theoretical displacement follow the same exponential trend, with the theoretical values being greater than experimental. After 0.475 seconds, the difference between the displacement values reaches around 0.05 meters. The higher overall theoretical values compared to the experimental is due to both theoretical velocity and acceleration being higher than the respective experimental values.
Overall, there is a discrepancy between the theoretical and experimental data. The car may have been bumped, or there could have been some tension or slack in the cable. We have ignored friction force and assumed damping constant K is close to the true value.
However, also in this graph right here, the slow initial velocity is more prevalent this time due to the human error, as the car was released manually. It may have been a slight push backwards that had decreased the initial acceleration.